Wherever you've been or what you've gone through, the Father is waiting for you. Let's begin a new family. You're welcome at our house.
Welcome to Ron Phillips from Abba's House. I'm Angie McGregor.
And I'm Pastor Ron Phillips, and I believe the Holy Spirit is going to take you to a new level of freedom today.
Do you ever feel like there's something wrong controlling you and you just can't put your finger on it? Well, you may be dealing with a stronghold.
And a stronghold, Angie, is a pattern of wrong thinking.
Yes.
It may be something you've been taught, a curse that's been put on you, and that curse can sometimes just be a word someone has said, like you're stupid or you're dumb. And you get that pattern of wrong thinking, and before long, a demonic entity moves in and begins to oppress you and to create issues in your life. And you can be diagnosed, you can go through all kinds of prayer, and it's still there.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says strongholds have to be cast down, and spirits have to be told to leave. Today, we're going to teach you how to do that and help you do that. And when we finish today, you're going to walk in a new level of freedom. Stay tuned for this powerful, liberating message. I want to get right to it. I want to talk about tearing down strongholds tonight. And I want you to take your Bible and turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 10, please. Beginning in verse 3. Let's stand up again in reverence for God's Word. For though we walk in the flesh, this is verse 3, 2 Corinthians 10, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, not of the flesh, but mighty in God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. And the verse nobody understands, but God has given me revelation. It's, nobody knows how to interpret it, but I'm going to show you something in a minute. And being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Father, right now, we ask you to do warfare in this room and around the world on television tonight. We come against those sinister and dark forces that lie underneath all of our problems tonight. We thank you that we're not fighting for a victory, but from a victory. We thank you, Lord, that at Calvary you spoiled principalities and powers and made a public show of them. You triumphed over them. Help us here tonight, Lord, to enforce what the blood has already done and to see people walk in freedom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated. In his last trip to the United States of America, Dr. James S. Stewart, the chaplain to the Queen, distinguished professor of New Testament at Edinburgh University, and probably one of the greatest preacher theologians of the 20th century, wrote a little book called A Faith to Proclaim. He was lecturing in an Ivy League university. Now, they didn't get it, but I want to take just a minute, if I may, to read a brief statement that he said, reflecting on what he saw coming. Now understand, this was in the late 1950s. And he said this, were Paul to come back today and look upon the tragic conflict of our world, he would still say that our wrestling is not against flesh and blood, not against any group of men or nations, Caesarism, communism, Islam, as though the interest of democracy were somehow synonymous with the righteous God. It's not that simple and naive as that. God pity the facile imagination which assumes our own policies are blameless and our own hands clean. No, the real warfare cuts across all such alignments and lies deeper down in the invisible realm where sinister forces stand flaming and fanatic against the rule of Christ. And the only way to meet that demonic, mystic passion is with the dunamis, the power and passion of the Lord. Was it not Christ's declared intention to kindle that in the human heart? He said, I am come to send fire on the earth. For only spirit can conquer spirit. The children of darkness are wiser than we in this. The devil knows better than to stifle emotion. And it is no use in a day when spirit forces of passionate evil have been unleashed upon the earth and when fierce emotions are tearing our world apart, it's no use having a milk and water passionless theology. No good setting a tepid Christianity against a scorching paganism. The thrust of the demonic has to be met with the fire of the divine. And indeed it can, since Christ has overcome the world. If there was ever a prophetic word spoken by a theologian in the Ivy League universities where most of our presidents have been educated, it was by Professor Stewart. He saw that the conflict isn't with poor Muslim friends who are enslaved by demonic theology. It's not even about those who are in the White House. Because behind and underneath all the world forces of darkness, there are what Paul called principalities, powers, dark forces of evil. Even science has embraced the truth that we live in a universe with parallel dimensions. There's a spiritual dimension where God is worshipped. It's called the heavenlies in Ephesians chapter 6. But also the Bible says, in that realm we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. There are rulers over every region, every continent of America. There are demonic forces over Washington, D.C. The Bible identifies the principality of Iran, the prince of Persia. Daniel fought him, and we're still fighting that same principality today. They still hate Israel. We're still fighting those same struggles. If some of these people that believe you can tear out territorial spirits have done such a good job, they hadn't made it, have they? We're still wrestling against those same dark forces. When Jesus established the church, he declared war. He looked at Peter and he said, upon this rock I'll build my church, the rock of your confession of Christ, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now, listen to me. He wasn't talking about a bunch of gates attacking you. That's not what the Greek text says. He recognized that people were in prison, spiritual prison. They were in darkness. Jesus' first message we find in Luke 4, he said, I've come to proclaim liberty to the captive. Jesus saw the human condition not as having a bad day, but men who are blind and lost and broken and in darkness. And even those who believe, Paul was aware, could be infected and infested, not possessed, but oppressed, depressed, suppressed, compressed with what we call demonic strongholds. And so tonight, I want to take a few moments to talk to you about getting rid of demonic strongholds and the war that we're in the church. I want you to understand, I love you, all of you here, the pastors, our members, but when I look out of here, I see a habitation of dragons. Some of you think you've had a bad day or you've got a bad habit and you've got a demonic stronghold in your life. And nobody knows, but God knows when you turn on that computer what you're looking at. Nobody may know here, but your family knows you've cursed them and slapped them. God knows all those little secret places of our lives. And the church is being ripped apart. We've tried to let psychology counsel out what has to be cast out. Is anybody here with me tonight? And I'm not against great counseling. We have great counselors in our church. But I'm telling you, folks, the battle, the war is on and is against the enemy. When Solomon, in Song of Solomon, wrote prophetically about the coming of the bride, the church, he described the church this way. Who is she who looks forth as the morning, fair as the moon, clear as the sun, awesome as an army with banners? It's time for the bride to put on her combat boots and take back the territory of our cities and our schools and our communities and our nations. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
The Bible says, your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Ignoring him won't make him go away. You must know who he is, how he works, and how you can defeat him. In Everyone's Guide to Demons and Spiritual Warfare, Pastor Ron Phillips teaches you simple, powerful tools for outmaneuvering Satan in your daily life. You learn the history of your enemy, how to identify the symptoms of demonic activity, how to defeat Satan's strategies, and how to arm yourself for victory. Call now, 1-800-877-6493, or order online at ronphillips.org, or send a money order or check to Ron Phillips, P.O. Box 937, Hickson, Tennessee, 37343. You can walk in freedom. Call now for Everyone's Guide to Demons and Spiritual Warfare, 1-800-877-6493.
Well, where does this battle rage? I believe Joyce Meyer's right when she said it is the battle of the mind. You see, when God created man, He created you, a trinity, a body, a soul, and a spirit. And with that creation, He gave you a mind to think, a heart to love, and a will to choose. That makes you different from a dog or a monkey. Now, I know some people that believe they were evolved here. And looking around, well, never mind that. With Adam's mind, he let him name the animals. With his heart, he pulled a rib out of his side and made a woman for him to love. And with his will, there was a tree over there in the garden that gave him a choice and made him different and gave him a will in the image of God. The Bible says that God breathed into Adam the breath of life and he became a living soul. That's nephesh. You say, well, I have a soul. No, you don't. You are a soul. You can't divide it. Only the Word of God can divide the spirit and soul asunder. That's why when somebody comes to me and says, well, I know my heart, I get nervous. Because I've had them walk in my office and say, well, you know, God told me, you know, I don't love my wife anymore and the Lord's led me to somebody else. I want to say, you lying whoremonger, you. I forgot I'm on television. Or I don't love my wife anymore. Well, I said, the Bible says love your enemies. What you talking about? I want to say, who do you love? Who do you love? We're living in a world where the enemy gains entry, listen to me, through your mind. With your body, you are world conscious. With your mind, you are self-conscious. And with your spirit, you're God conscious. But I want to talk to you for a moment before I move into deliverance from strongholds about thinking, about your mind. Now, I want to pull out a verse that we charismatics love. Baptists. 3 John 2. Everybody loves this prosperity verse. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. And you get over in a charismatic movement like our church and you'll get somebody, they'll say, whoo, I had a little shout over at the church. My soul's prospering. So where's my money? That's not what that verse says. Are you ready for this? This is the ugly part of the sermon, okay? Brace yourself for this. Because I want to tell you exactly what this verse says. As your soul prospers, the word soul in the Greek language is psyche. Look at your neighbor and say, mind. Psychology is the study of the mind. It's how you think. So here's what this really says. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health because your thinking and your mind is right. I want you to prosper and be in health because the eye gate of your life is only letting truth and what is righteous come into your life. I want you to prosper because what you're hearing is the Word of God. And faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. I want you to prosper because your five senses are taking in what they're supposed to take in. There's no way the computer programmers have a saying, guy go, garbage in, garbage out. You can't sit in front of hell's box office and pornography and trash and then think you're going to have some kind of spiritual breakthrough in your life. It's not going to happen. And I don't want to get ugly, but even the news media, whether it's liberal or conservative, if you listen to that, you'll be depressed all the time. Because Jesus walked into a world where they were under the heel of Rome, their nation was enslaved, and he said, I got some good news for you. You got to get your mind right. You got to quit thinking stupid. Your health and prosperity depends on letting God control your thinking. Your mind, your soul, and spirit is what's in the image of God. So what you think, how you love, and what you choose will determine who you are and what you have. Now here's the ugly part of the message. All the prayer, all the Hyundai, Shandai, bow tie, necktie, all the running the aisles, all the speaking in tongues, a gallon of anointing oil and four prayer shawls can't make up for stupid. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Present your body a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your spiritual service of worship. Be not conformed to this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You want prosperity? That's true. You can have it. But you need to let God begin to think His thoughts through you. And the Bible tells us that our health, our prosperity, our blessing is dependent on who we let program what's going on in our life. When God said you ought to pray every day and read the Bible every day, that wasn't a suggestion. That's something to make you well. That's something to help you in your life. And so I wanted to just get that out of the way. When understanding that, then how do we get rid of these strongholds out of our lives? Well, first you need to know what a stronghold is. Understand that a stronghold is not a demon. I said to you, a stronghold is not even the Greek word, means a fortress. I think Francis Frangipane has defined it best of all. He says it's a house of wrong thinking. That's what it is. A stronghold is a house of wrong thinking. In other words, even if you're sincere, if you believe a lie, that lie invites a demon to come and live in that stronghold. And that's what happens. If you're thinking, you're looking, you're doing, you're acting, you're believing, your actions are not what they ought to be, those wrong actions will invite a demon to come and he'll encourage you to stay in that lie or in that sin. That's how people get captive to these kinds of things. Now, it works in a way like terrorism. In November of 2009, a major, a psychologist in the military at Fort Hood, Oklahoma, picked up a gun and cried, Allahu Akbar, and murdered 13 American soldiers and wounded 35 others. He was a citizen of this country. He was part of our military. He had sworn loyalty to the American government. And I believe when he started out, because I've studied his history, he started out that way. But he started going to a mosque. And a radical imam got a hold of him. And folks, you got another one here besides Glenn Beck that believes we're in a mess in this country because of this kind of teaching and thinking in these mosques. Something happened to that man. It wasn't long until that old Islamic devil had taken hold of him again. And he picked up an AK-47 one day and martyred our brothers and sisters because he thought it was the right thing to do. So now, his lawyer says he was crazy. Well, the problem was he had a demon. He had a demonic, I'm going to call it what it is. He had a demonic stronghold. And by the way, most of the people in our jails, most serial killers who kill women and rape them, started out looking at pornography. So you think about that when you're hitting the computer. A stronghold is a house of wrong thinking that invites a demonic entity to hide in that stronghold in your life. Okay. Whatever the flesh is in control of in a Christian's life can invite demons to move into that place in your mind. Now, it's usually this simple. It's an unconfessed sin. It's a hidden thing. Maybe it wasn't your fault. Maybe you were abused, but now you're so hateful and bitter over it that a demon of rage and hatred keeps you from enjoying any kind of relationship. There are women in this audience and listening to me on television. You can't make love to your husband because of what happened to you as a child, and it's destroying your marriage. There are men who have been involved in filthy pornography, and you're killing your marriage because you're trying to make your wife into what you've seen on a video. I'm going to talk the truth here tonight. Young people, don't think you can listen to that demon-possessed music and it not affect your life. I'm telling you, these strongholds are real. You say, well, I'm just going to smoke one joint and you end up on heroin. That's how the enemy operates. That's how Satan operates. Now, let me describe some of these strongholds. Now, there are 12 of them here. See, I'm on television. I have a time limit, so don't get nervous. But I'm going to just list these, and I'm going to talk about three or four of them. Is that okay? Now, how did I pick these? Because everywhere the Bible called it a spirit, I decided that's a spirit, all right? Number one, the spirit of infirmity. In Luke 13:11, behold, there was a woman who had a spirit of infirmity 18 years and bent over and could in no way raise herself up. The sad thing about this poor woman was she was in the synagogue. She had been attending for 18 years, and nobody could help her. But finally, one day, Jesus showed up and said, honey, there ain't anything wrong with your back but a devil on it. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get off. And that woman stood up straight. And I want to tell you, the demon may not have caused your sickness, but every time I've gotten sick, a demon showed up. Showed me the graveyard. I mean, I'm getting ready to have knee surgery, and the devil comes in and said, you're going to have a heart attack, die on the table. Woke me up at 3 o'clock in the morning and told me that. I said, you're a liar, a murderer, and a thief. You have no standing in my life, and you can't stay. I command you to leave, and I turned over and went back to sleep. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? The spirit of fear. I may come back to this one. See, the opposite of fear is faith. This is one I battle all the time. And I'm looking at you preachers, and you know, you'll have a great day on Sunday, and everything's fine. And some deacon look at you cross-eyed, and you're upset for 3 days. You know how we are. You know, we're worse than the children of Israel. God do a miracle after miracle, and then we just think, well, it's over. Because something bad goes. I'm talking to some of you, aren't I? The fear of man, the scripture says, brings a snare, and that snare is a stronghold. Number three, the spirit of the occult. In Acts 16:16, here was a girl with a spirit of divination, and the Greek word is pythias or python. She had got herself involved occultically, reading horoscopes the way you do it today, you know, getting into the witchcraft stuff, and that's going on around here, and that thing coiled around her like a snake and was squeezing life out of her. Number four, the spirit of immorality, Hosea 4:12. The Bible says a spirit of harlotry has caused him to go astray. I like the King James, whoredoms. But all this is the spirit that takes sex out of the context of a marriage between a man and a woman and puts it in any other context will bring on demonic involvement. It may be homosexual. It may be fornication, which is a girl and a guy or two guys. I don't know where. It's everything outside of marriage. Or adultery. It's wrong. An enslaving spirit, which can be connected to any of these. At Romans 8:15, you did not receive a spirit of bondage. If there's anything controlling your life, whatever kind of habit it is, whether it's food, as some of us struggle with, or tobacco, or liquor, or television, or spending too much money, or some habit, something you can't get out of, if there's a pattern in your life and it keeps repeating itself and things aren't getting any better, quit being stupid and get rid of that stronghold out of your life. Identify.
Well, the Bible says you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free. And the truth is, it's not a bad habit, it's a stronghold, and you can be free today.
That's right, and we've helped you identify some of those strongholds today. And by the way, Angie, in next week's program,
Yes. We'll
be identifying more. And once you come to the truth, you can tear down that stronghold, you can confess it, or you can forsake it, or you can say to what was done to you, Lord, I'm letting it go.
Yeah.
And you can begin to walk in a new level of freedom. We want to help you walk in freedom here at Abbott's House. And for that reason, we have prepared some resources for you.
You know, Pastor Ron has done a lot of study on the demonic world. And his great book, Everyone's Guide to Demons and Spiritual Warfare, is a tool that you need in your library.
Even if you call us on the phone and we pray with you, you still need to say, I want the book. Because in that book, the last section, the last five chapters, tell you how to walk in freedom and give you the very steps for freedom. So get on the phone now and call. Let us pray for you and let us get this book rushed out to you.
The Bible says, your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Ignoring him won't make him go away. You must know who he is, how he works, and how you can defeat him. In Everyone's Guide to Demons and Spiritual Warfare, Pastor Ron Phillips teaches you simple, powerful tools for outmaneuvering Satan in your daily life. You'll learn the history of your enemy, how to identify the symptoms of demonic activity, how to defeat Satan's strategies, and how to arm yourself for victory. Call now, 1-800-877-6493, or order online at ronphillips.org, or send a money order or check to Ron Phillips, P.O. Box 937, Hickson, Tennessee, 37343. You can walk in freedom. Call now for Everyone's Guide to Demons and Spiritual Warfare, 1-800-877-6493.
Let the fire fall, a fire that opens blind eyes and brings sinners to Jesus.
He's looking for somebody with some crazy faith that says, God, I can't do it, but I got a God that can.
It's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit.
Get the complete messages from the 2012 Fresh Oil and New Wine Conference and learn how to unlock heaven in your life. Call now, 1-800-877-6493, or visit ronphillips.org. Abba's House is a place of forgiveness, healing, and hope. That's why Pastor Phillips would like to hear from you and invites you to join us in partnership to take this media ministry to the nations of the world. So call the number on your screen to discover how you can become a partner with Ron Phillips Ministries today. And check out our website at ronphillips.org. So join us again next week. You're always welcome at Abba's House.
Welcome.